This ghost town in the German city of Heidelberg used to be a bustling US Army base, housing nearly 5,000 people. But it's been closed for more than a decade. Like many old bases around Germany, it would usually continue to rot or be torn down. Instead, this mini city is up for a makeover and is part of a massive urban experiment. While many of the nearly 300 buildings here are set to be refurbished, those that don't fit into the plans aren't just going to be demolished. They'll be picked apart and their materials will either be recycled or reused. This technique is called urban mining, a construction trend that's picking up steam around the world. So, how exactly does it work and can it live up to the hype? Built in the 1950s as part of the US military's significant Cold War presence in West Germany, Patrick Henry Village was an American island on the outskirts of Heidelberg. Like many US Army bases, it was basically its own little city, with housing for thousands of soldiers and their families, schools, a church, a bowling alley, and most importantly,
it even had American fast food chains you couldn't find in the rest of Germany.
But after US troops relocated to nearby Wiesbaden in 2012, Patrick Henry Village became a ghost town, leaving behind thousands of American appliances and even outlets. Since then, the area has only been used in part to temporarily house refugees. The city has grand plans to redevelop the village into a shiny new district with housing for thousands, offices, and green spaces. That would typically mean mass demolishing and getting rid of these old houses and putting up entirely new ones. But old buildings are only a problem if we see them as such.
Wir machen hier ein urban mining Konzept im Sinne der Circular City, also der kreislaufgerechten Stadt, wo wir das, was Menschenhand hier hinterlassen hat, eigentlich wie eine Mine im Bergbau begreifen wollen.
Jürgen Otschuk is Heidelberg's deputy mayor and heads up its city planning department.
Es sind Bodenschätze, die uns hier eigentlich gegeben sind. Und diese Schätze wollen wir auch wertschätzen und wollen mit diesen Materialien diesen neuen Stadtteil bauen.
Roughly one third of the buildings will be left standing, gutted and renovated. The rest will be taken down to make space for a denser neighborhood with mixed-use buildings, not just housing. But the special thing about this project is that instead of sending the deconstructed buildings to landfill, the goal is to resell, reuse, or recycle everything that you can see here, from literally the ground up.
While windows like these could typically be reused, the changing energy standards since these were put in means that they can't be. They can, though, be recycled, a tricky process, but it's possible. Concrete can either be reused or recycled as well. But then, we've got to find a home for all these big old American fridges in Germany.
While those will be a tough sell, all of this represents a new approach to old buildings and goods.
Jeder Quadratmeter, den man gar nicht baut, ist erstmal der beste Quadratmeter. Alles, was man nachnutzen kann, soll man nachnutzen.
Improving how we build things is vital. Construction accounts for 13% of global energy-related carbon emissions. And it's not just about putting up buildings. When buildings are demolished, they usually end up in landfill. All told, construction and demolition account for about one-third of all waste in Europe. Projects like the one in Heidelberg can do their part to change this, but it didn't actually start here. It started in an office in Stuttgart, about 100 kilometers south.
The first step is actually to get an idea of what you have.
Matthias Heinrich works for ETEA, an environmental consulting company that's partnered with Heidelberg to build a database of the city's building stock, starting with Patrick Henry Village.
So you need to know exactly how much material you have, what is the properties of the material, are there hazardous substances, for instance.
ETEA can estimate a building's construction materials based on its age and location. And its database helps cities like Heidelberg get a sense of reusable and recyclable materials at their disposal when planning new projects. Heidelberg then confirms the estimates. That means boring holes in the floors, walls, and ceilings, and making a checklist of everything left hanging around the former base.
Here it shows you that over 52% of the building is actually concrete. Mm-hmm. And around 5% is metal, and this is like a first overview of the inventory. Mm-hmm.
This information is tracked for the whole neighborhood, with a breakdown of all 500,000 tons of material.
Look, I know this seems a bit dry, but without any of this documentation and all of these databases, none of the actual mining of urban mining is remotely possible.
Urban mining is the systematic management of everything that's man-made, so before everything is coming to waste. So how do we manage materials so they don't become waste, but we can use them again as a resource.
While urban mining, sometimes called circular construction, is a new term and has begun to take off in the last 5 to 10 years, it's not a new principle.
Up until the Industrial Revolution, actually, urban mining was very common.
Nico Schouten focuses on the built environment at Dutch sustainability consultancy Metabolic.
During the Industrial Revolution, and I think that's what we see with a lot of production processes, production became cheaper, mass consumption became more common, and we kind of let go of reusing what we already have.
Metabolic's urban mining efforts include partnering with cities, architects, and construction companies.
I think a very interesting case that we've worked on is the building of the Dutch National Bank.
The 14-story skyscraper was entirely disassembled. Metabolic are working with the developer to design a new building from the secondary materials. They've also built an office park out of old houseboats. Similar urban mining projects have popped up from Switzerland to Belgium. And cities in the US are increasingly building material databases and passing laws that require buildings to be deconstructed, not demolished. But urban mining isn't one size fits all.
The way we try to solve the problem is not the same in different regions, in different countries.
Usha Iyer-Raniga researches the built environment and co-leads the UN's Sustainable Buildings Program. In the Global South, for example, there just aren't as many empty houses, offices, and shops as in the Global North. But in a way, urban mining is pretty big here, even though people don't necessarily call it that.
When you think of informal settlements, for instance, they are very circular in that the materials that have been used in these informal settlements have had several lives before they end up in these informal areas.
In Heidelberg, this process is a lot more bureaucratic.
Painstakingly documenting every tile in an entire mini city by color may seem a little bit crazy, but you never know when it might help. And that's not even the hard part. It's now that the real fun begins.
Things that can be directly reused will need to be sold.
Wir haben ja auch hier 2000 Küchen und Einbauschränke, ich weiß nicht wie viele. Wir haben Steckdosen und Toilettenschüsseln und Waschbecken und Armaturen. Also Armaturen kann man vielleicht weiter verwenden, wenn man einen Markt dafür findet. Inzwischen hat sich in Deutschland doch ein Gebrauchtmarkt entwickelt, der immer lebendiger, immer vitaler wird. Das freut uns sehr.
The buildings themselves will have to be picked apart. And then you need to figure out what to do with the materials.
Take the 90,000 tons of brick at Patrick Henry Village. Most of that will be able to be reused to some degree. But for the 230,000 tons of concrete, it's a different story.
Wir werden den Beton natürlich verarbeiten müssen. Er wird gemahlen werden. Er wird vielleicht zum Teil als gebrochenes Material neuen Beton zugefügt. Er wird zum Teil als Unterbau von Straßen verwendet. Also das sind sozusagen die verschiedenen Verwertungswege, die wir entwickelt haben, und zwar für jede Art von Materialien. Und das sind viele.
Even if we start cataloging and mining our buildings on a grand scale, we'll never be able to entirely eliminate the use of new building materials.
It's not just about how we deconstruct what's already here. It's also about rethinking how we build.
So usually in a building, you design a building and then you find materials that fit. But if you have to design with a set of materials, then you really have to shift your way of thinking. And really have also a different position as an architect in this whole process and be more of an assembler of materials instead of a designer of a building.
We'll need to use different materials if we want to make future urban mining easier. With that in mind, EPA builds with materials that are primed for easy reuse, hence all of the untreated wood furniture in their office. They've also designed a circularity passport for new buildings that logs materials for future reference, and tracking this data could soon be a requirement in Germany. Despite the different contexts, lessons from these projects could be useful all over the world.
If we are going to be building, say, office buildings in the Global South, can we design these buildings so that these buildings could be deconstructed easily in 20 or 30 years or 40 years?
But to make this happen in the first place, they just might have to cut some red tape, which is something Heidelberg's planners know all about.
Wir müssen wirklich intensiv aufpassen, dass das Material, was wir hier haben, niemals rechtlich Abfall wird. Weil sobald Abfall ist, haben wir ein Riesenthema. Es dürfen nur noch ganz bestimmte Betriebe diese Materialien dann sozusagen entsorgen.
And with individual urban mining projects starting to pop up all over the place, governments will have to help coordinate these complicated logistics. And they'll also have to step in to help overcome what might be the biggest challenge, cost.
So when you look at virgin materials, they emit a lot of CO2 and they're very harmful for the environment, but they're often a lot cheaper than secondary materials because labor is quite expensive in our current system.
Incentivizing urban mining and making it cheaper will help drive change, but it will still take time. Projects like Heidelberg's Patrick Henry Village redevelopment are a start, but also show just how much has to change to get within a sniff of those goals.
Also wir müssen wirklich schauen, dass wir ganz viele Menschen von dieser Vorgehensweise begeistern können, damit möglichst viele Baustoffe nicht mehr irgendwo auf die Deponien gebracht werden, sondern eben dieses Kreislaufarbeiten, dieses Kreislaufdenken, dass das auch in der Bauwirtschaft auch ankommt.
Let us know in the comments if there are any urban mining projects happening where you live. Thanks a lot for watching, and don't forget to subscribe. We've got new videos for you every Friday.